Good evening. Welcome to the Siddhaveda webinar series. Today the topic is on holistic nutrition. The speaker is Dr. Gauri Rokam. Gauri Rokam is a holistic nutritionist, public speaker, yoga and nature cure therapist. She blends principles of sound nutrition, yoga and natural hygiene to clients to fulfill their health and fitness goals with vibrant health. Holding a PhD in yoga and life sciences and then master's in food and nutrition, Dr. Rokam believes that true health needs to be educated and that the preventive measures and mindfulness can be a much better way than even diets and treatments. Our endeavor is to help out people to understand the ability of self-healing. I welcome Dr. Gauri Rokam to start the webinar today. Thanks.
Thank you, Doctor. A very good evening to all of you and my respectful pranams to each one of you who have joined in to this session. I bring greetings from India and Happy New Year, Happy Yugadi to all of you. I know we are facing a very challenging time, but I think we should take this as an opportunity to correct ourselves because we have done enough damage to ourselves, mind, body, and the ecology. And this lecture is one in this direction. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Shan and also Mr. Surya Deva, who connected me to Dr. Shan and start this lecture. Thank you, Doctor.
You're welcome.
You can see the screen?
Not yet. It's
now?
Yeah.
Yes.
We can see, yes.
Right.
Okay.
Now, I would just like to take a minute to talk about myself. My father is a naturopath and a yoga exponent, besides being a biochemistry professor. So I grew up seeing his teaching, healing people, and I knew the potency of what food can do to us. But there were times when I felt I would not get, you know, the so-called scientific logical answers to my questions, and I decided I'm going to learn more about it myself and joined into this degree of food and nutrition. I went on to do master's in food and nutrition and stood first in the university, and then realized I was thoroughly confused now because what my textbooks taught me were almost contradicting to what was my life's experiences. So at 21, I couldn't understand how two different philosophies could be almost contradicting to each other and which was right and which was wrong. And that is when my unofficial research started. And thankfully, there was no Google to answer my questions. And, I literally had to go to experts to get my answers. And there also I had a problem because each one would declare, I'm right, everybody else is wrong. And so that's how I figured out every single concept by understanding from different experts, you know, experiencing it, experimenting it. And in these 25 years, seeing thousands of clients and see them heal themselves. Today, I think I do understand food a bit, and I'm here to share my thoughts and understanding. And I think we are in a very strange situation today where we have to take charge of our health. The two industries we were depending on haven't done good to us. You know, food which is being provided is almost leading us to sickness, and the medical industry, which should take care of prevention, is right now dealing with diseases and sick people. So it is very important for all of us to become responsible for our health. Now let me get straight into the subject. And because for the want of time, which is very short, I'm going to be very brief and also very quick. Of course, there could be many more occasions where we can go deal with it more in depth. Well, when we come to food, we always think what is on our plate is food. But Taittiriya Upanishad very clearly declares that everything on this universe is made up of five basic natural elements called the Panchabhutas. These are the Panchabhutas. Earth is the grossest, and as we go ahead, it becomes subtler and subtler, and space is the subtlest. Now, I want to deal with each of them briefly and see how we can use them in our daily life. Because if we are made up of all these elements, we need all of these elements on a daily basis as food to keep this body in health. Let's start with space, the ether. This is the most potent because it's the subtlest. And especially when it comes to India, we have always seen our parents, or at least our grandparents, doing fasting. But we did not know why they were fasting. And today, science is talking about fasting. 2016, Dr. Osumi, a cell biologist from Japan, got a Nobel Prize for deciphering the mechanism behind fasting. Before I go to speak about what he said or what he invented, let me tell you in simple terms what this means to us. Now, if you look at our daily life for a common man, as we wake up, we have a beverage, and most people even eat some biscuits or things like that. And after that, even before it settles down and body tries to digest and assimilate that, we have our breakfast. And we have been taught by the medical nutrition that this meal should be the richest, biggest meal. Of course, it should be the richest and the most wonderful in its quality, not in its quantity and richness. Anyway, we have this breakfast. And by the time it again goes in and finds its way, a mid-morning snack or a drink comes in. And after that comes another large meal called lunch, and evening something to drink and eat. And by then we are ready for dinner, and many more people even drink something just before they go to bed. Now just imagine what's happening to the gut. From the minute I wake up till almost 4 or 5 hours after I sleep, my gut is busy digesting, absorbing, assimilating the food I have eaten through the day. So it's a huge mess happening inside, if you understand and ask me. Now, if I say fasting, no inputs at all, look at what's happening. Now my brain says, oh wow, the gut has almost no work to do. So I have a lot of energy and time. What do I do? It's like, you know, you recollect what you do in the weekends. Whole of the week, you throw things here and there because you don't have time. But in the weekend, you start saying, okay, I have all the time, let me clean up. Exactly like that the body behaves. It says, I have all the time, I have a lot of energy and no job to do, let me take up cleaning work. Detoxification happens inside the system. Repair work happens inside the system. That's why fasting was considered as one of the most important, you know, practices, and it was weaved into the lifestyle itself. Every few days, of course, different communities in India had different ways of fasting, but everybody fasted, and that's how they kept themselves probably healthy. Now, what did Dr. Osumi say? He went on to say that even damage at the DNA level can be corrected during fasting. It is that potent. And our people had declared, not today, long, long, long time back, thousands of years back, that it is called langhanam param aushadham. Langhanam is fasting, Paramaushadam. There is no better medicine or better treatment for any disease or disorder, or to correct anything inside the body and mind, than fasting. So what did Osumi say? He worked on something called autophagy. Autophagy is a process where a wrong cell or a rogue cell or a cell which has wrong material, which has, for some reason, whatever the reason, it has wrong information. It is not going to replicate itself or multiply itself and go on to digest itself and kill itself when this fasting happens. Autophagy is switched on or triggered off during fasting. And that's why it was very important. And of course, fasting should never become starving. What is starving? When I'm fasting and all my thoughts are around food. Oh my God, I have not eaten. Oh my God, I have not eaten. When will I eat? What will I eat? This is starving. Our people never did starving. They always fasted with a prayer. Because, see, during fasting, what happens is, this is the spiritual aspect of our system. That is, when it comes to yogic philosophy or nature cure, this is where our system comes in. It says, all our senses are turned outwards most of the time. But during fasting, it turns inwards. The journey happens inwards. That's why the beautiful name, the Sanskrit name, Upavasa. Upa is near and Vasa is to live. What is this near and where are we going near to? This is going nearer to ourselves. Whatever you want to name, nature, God, Atma, self, whatever you want to call, you're going towards that, understanding yourself. And believe me, each client of mine, after experiencing fasting for a period of time, come back with miracles happening in their lives. They see a huge transformation happening in themselves because this journey of going inwards has started. So it becomes very important to inculcate fasting on a regular basis. And very briefly to tell you, start with small steps. Do half a day, then a full day, and then a 24 hours. Whatever you can practically do. If you have a disease, if you are dealing with obesity or overweight, you can choose to do once a week. Otherwise, you can always do once in 15 days. And our ancient people had fixed it on the first day of the month, which is called Ekadashi. In a month, we get 2 days. That is 11th day after a full moon and 11th day after a new moon. So you can either do once in 15 days, or if you have medical issues, you can do once in a week. And just to give you a understanding of how to do. When you start, the first time you do, don't have anything in the morning as a beverage or no breakfast also. Be on water. Drink water in sips whenever you want to, how much ever you want. Go till lunchtime. When I say lunchtime, I'm not specifying any time here. Till your body can manage or be comfortable. When you feel I cannot do it anymore, it could be 12 o'clock, it could be 1 o'clock, it could be 2 o'clock, anytime you want to, you can break it with a meal of fruits. So lunch will be a huge bowl of fruits, preferably all sweet fruits. And evening, have a tender coconut water. If you get fresh tender coconut water, not the bottled tender coconut water. If you don't get any fresh fruit juice made at home, diluted 50% with water will do a good job in the evening. And night, you can go to eating a simple, healthy cooked meal. What is the simple, healthy cooked meal? I'll come to it in a bit. So start practicing fasting half day like this for some weeks. After 4-5 weeks, your body will get used to it and it will even forget that it has not had breakfast. Then you can start doing the whole day. That is till evening. Be on water till evening. And evening, whenever you feel comfortable, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, break your fast with a tender coconut water or a diluted fresh fruit juice. And night, have fruits for dinner. And next day, go back to eating your normal routine of eating. So doing this 8-10 hours of fasting once a week will keep us healthy, prevent many, many diseases and disorders, even reverse many diseases, and also our weight will be taken care of. Now I'm going moving on to the next element called air. Now I'm going to talk about one aspect when I say I'm talking about all of these concepts. In air, I'm going to talk about the concept of prana. And I'm sure Indians are very familiar with prana, but to just make it very clear, prana is the basic life force present in all of us. Just to clarify, if we take an example of a dead body and a person in coma, the person in coma has none of his organs working. Everything is connected to a gadget and a machine is working for him. But we still consider or call him alive. Why? Because this basic life force called prana is present. The minute the prana leaves, we declare him dead. So this is what is prana. And our yogic texts tell us that we have a pranic system inside our body, very similar to the circulatory system, where blood flows in the channels. Here prana, or the life force or the energy, flows in these channels. We have a main nadi in the backbone called the Sushumna nadi, and it has two more nadis beside it, the Ida and the Pingala, the left and the right nadis, which branch out into 72,000 nadis and reach every part of our body and supply energy. And this is subdivided again into 5 Mukhya Pranas and Upa Pranas and much more. Let me not get into the details, but we have specific way of flow of prana in these channels. If there is more energy, less energy, blockage of energy, or even the change of direction of energy flow, we have an imbalance, disharmony in this pranic system, which leads to vyadhi or disorder in the physical body. So it's very important to keep this energy system in balance. How can we do it? Simple nadi shuddhi pranayama, or the alternate nostril breathing done every day, is going to do this job. So a minimum of around, say, 9 rounds of nadi shuddhi pranayama done every day, slowly and properly. When I say properly, Sadhguru says, put a feather under your nose, it should not flutter. It should be done so softly and nicely with the mind here. That is what is the most important. If we do it mechanically, we almost don't get any benefits other than the physical benefits. But when we put our mind together and do it very peacefully, then we start getting these physiological benefits. Okay. So not just about balancing this pranic system, but there's a huge benefit for the respiratory system, because we start using our lungs to a larger capacity, which brings in our immune system into the play, and our immune system also gets better. But what is most important here to note is that our nervous system gets relaxed and mind gets calmer. And this is the holistic way of looking at this system. Now I'm moving on to the next element called sun. And we all know this is the life force for everything, all life on earth, right? Primary, force of life. Now, a lot of research is being done all over the world about sun's light and heat and how they're beneficial. Of course, I can speak the next 1 hour about sun only, but it is that much of data we have today. Just to give very important ones, the first one is, when we expose our skin to the sunlight, whatever is on the skin, which is the biggest barrier between the outside and the inside, whatever that is, virus, bacteria, fungus, molds, everything gets killed and they don't have a chance to enter our bodies. The second thing is on exposure to the sunlight, under the skin, vitamin D is made. This vitamin D is an important component in many metabolic activities of our body. And one of the important things is also better calcium absorption inside the body. And when better calcium absorption happens, our skeletal system, that is the bones and the teeth, become stronger and healthier. Then another aspect is when exposed to sunlight, our mental health gets. We have data of positive direction in many, many diseases, right from mood changes to anxiety disorders to depression to the degenerative disorders like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's, that sun's heat and light has a huge effect because it produces those chemicals like serotonin and dopamine in our brains and makes us feel better. And it has a huge impact on our immune system because on exposure to the sunlight, the T cells responsible for our immunity or removing infection and inflammation move towards or the travel towards the site of infection and inflammation and remove infection and inflammation. And of course, it's common understanding that the respiratory system gets better or healthier on exposure to the sunlight. And Ayurveda claims that the digestive fire gets better. And we all know that digestion is the first step towards health. And if we can get this first step correct and complete, many, many more problems can be avoided through the whole body. And many more, of course, benefits. But now that we understand sun's light and energy is so important, how do we get the benefit of this? With minimum clothing, because the skin should be exposed directly to the sunlight. So wear minimum clothing, lie down in a place where you get direct sunlight and open your legs, open your arms and allow sunlight to touch every inch of your skin. And now you get all these benefits. Don't look at time because that's not what matters. See how you feel. You can take the sun bath as long as you're comfortable. It all depends on the harshness of the sun, not on the time. When you feel uncomfortable or the body gets heated up, you're done. Turn around and expose the back of your body to the sunlight. And again, wait till the body gets heated up and uncomfortable. And both the sides is done. When in the countries where we have good sunlight, even 3-4 minutes each side gives a good amount of sunlight exposure, right? So this way you can get benefits from the sun. Now coming on to water, most of us decide the amount of water we consume depending on some expert advice. That's a very wrong thing to do because the amount of water we need is quite specific to individual needs depending on how we lead our lives, what we do, what we eat, the climates, the moods, so many more things. So it is very important to have enough water, not less, not more. Not less because we are 70% water and all reactions inside our body happen in the medium of fluid. So it's very important to have enough fluids, but even excess is not a good idea, because kidneys are not sieves sitting there where you can simply drink any amount of water and they just flush it out. It's a huge amount of toll on the kidney cells. And again, we have understood it's a coordination between the kidney cells and the brain. And so it's a huge toll on the brain also. So it's necessary to have enough water. And what is this enough water? How do we decide? First thing is to listen to the body. And what is this thirst symptom? But having said this, I should also say that thirst is the last symptom coming out of the body before dehydration. So it's very important to get fluids as soon as we get dehydrated. In Nature Cure, Nature Cure talks about, you know, even getting natural fluids through natural fruits, vegetables, green leafy vegetables. So it's very important to get these kinds of water or fluid because they are rich in vitamins and minerals. So get them, most of them, in this way. And of course, drink enough water. It could be in the form of tender coconut water, sugarcane juice, or even, you know, all the fluids which we comes in our food also, like rasam and, you know, soups and things like that. But never have fruits and vegetables in the form of their liquids, like the juices and the smoothies. That's not what our body can handle. Our bodies needs to chew them and eat them. Right? Now, the another problem I have seen nowadays is we all work in ACs. So people don't even know the real thirst. So what we can do is look at the color of urine when you pee. If the color of urine is dark yellow, you need more fluids at that point of time. If the color of urine is light yellow or colorless, the amount of fluids you've had is perfectly fine. There are people, many, many of my clients who drink just 3/4 liter in a day and they're perfectly fine. That's all they want. So look at what you need, and this could change on an everyday basis. You don't have to fix the amount of water is what I'm trying to tell. Now coming to the earth, where we see what we eat every day coming out of the element earth. Now, this is by prescription, which means to say, every time when you pick up a plate, divide your plate into 4 parts. The first part should be coming from grains. The second part should be coming from your dals, grams, and nuts. The third part should be coming from vegetables and green leafy vegetables, which is cooked. The fourth part should be coming from vegetables and green leafy vegetables, which is raw. And of course, fruit should be a part of our daily eating, but not with the meal. This is my prescription. Now, if I say this is my prescription, I need to validate or, you know, defend myself that this plate provides all the nutrients required by my body. Let me do that first. Now, we know that we have specific nutrients which are required by a body on an everyday basis. The first one is carbohydrates. From this plate, where do I get carbohydrates? The first part, that is the grains. All grains give us carbohydrates. But that does not mean that grains give us only carbohydrates. Everything gives everything, but in different proportions. Grains give us carbohydrates to the maximum extent, and that's why we keep on talking that grains give us carbohydrates. I hope this is clear. And coming to the second major nutrient, which is protein. Where do I get it from this plate? All our legumes, that is grams, dals, and nuts, provide protein. Now coming to the fats, I'm sure all of you agree with me that we have used enough fats to prepare or cook this plate. So I'm not going to deal with fats at all. And coming to the vitamins and minerals, we get the vitamins and minerals from vegetables cooked, raw, and fruits. And the next nutrient is fiber. Where do we get? Generally, again, from the raw vegetables, cooked vegetables, and the fruits. And of course, we have discussed enough about the water. Now, these are the nutrients required by the body. There is nothing other than this. And this plate provides everything. So this is what I prescribe. Now, let me go into more details. If I translate that plate into normal eating, it will look like something similar to this. The first part, we will be either eating rotis or parathas, ragi ball or rice. The second part will be eating sambar or dals. The third part will be eating something like a sabzi, that is a vegetable dish. And the fourth part is the vegetable salad. So if you look at this closely, you will say, hello, we have been eating like this from day one. What is it new which you are teaching? And that's where the crux of the matter lies. This is the most important nutrient which has been neglected in modern times. And if we can bring in dietary fiber into our foods, we have done our jobs. Why? Look at what was happening. we have been on this earth from 200,000 years, and for most part of it, it is last 10,000 years only that we have started agriculture. Till then, we got something like 100 to 150 grams of fiber per day. Once we started agriculture, we started getting around 35 grams per day. And today, very sadly, we are getting around 15 grams of fiber. That too, if you're eating a standard American diet, which is almost called a sad diet, you're getting only 6 to 8 grams of fiber, which is the saddest part. And that is why we are getting into trouble. Let me explain why. Now, before getting into this picture, just understand that every plant product in its natural form has this tough outer covering called fiber. Earlier, we used to divide it into, you know, the soluble fiber, insoluble fiber and all that. Today, we don't do that because we have understood much more about the fiber. Soluble, insoluble, they change their properties and functions according to where and what the needs are. So we don't classify them anymore that way. We classify them as the, you know, carbohydrate, which is available for the microbiota. For the want of time, I'm not going to go into it. So now this fiber, the outermost layer, anything for that matter, was not made for me and you to eat. It was supposed to go into the soil to become the next baby plant. The nature's only purpose or the goal is procreation. That's all. Even for us, for that matter, it did not expect you and me to go to IITs, IIMs and become something. All it wanted was reproduce and leave so that I can continue my species. So in that direction, it has given this tough outer covering to protect that little seed in the environment or in the soil till it becomes a baby plant. And also to nourish and protect this baby plant, it gives all the micronutrients in the outermost layer. That is the vitamins, minerals, antioxidants, phytochemicals, flavonoids, all that. Name them, they're there in the outermost covering. Almost 70% of the micronutrients are in the outermost covering. Just to give you an example, I've picked it, this picture from a research paper. This is talking about a grain. Look at what comes from a refined, polished grain and the unpolished or the whole grain. The outermost part is the one which has the most nutrients and the germ which is there. So the outermost part becomes very, very important in all the food we eat. That is half the story, where the outermost part, if we retain the outermost part of the fiber, we get 60 to 70% of the nutrients loss will not happen. Now, let me come to the other part, the fiber itself. Fiber is the most important part of our food, which prevents from many, many diseases and disorders. I'm going to deal with only the lifestyle disorders today for the want of time again. Let me start with obesity. Fiber has two beautiful properties. One, we human beings do not have enzymes to break down this fiber. So if you eat food rich with fiber, it is going to stay in the stomach for a longer period of time, which translates into I don't get hungry again and again. The second property of fiber is to absorb water and become bulk. Once when it happens in the stomach, it adds satiety. That is, small amounts of food is going to make me feel fuller. And these two properties, that is, I will not get hungry again and again. And when I eat small quantities. Isn't this good enough to keep our weights in the right condition? I use this for everybody, whoever comes, even people who come with 3 digits. This is all I do, increase natural fiber in their food and they start losing weight. And of course, it doesn't happen in a day or two. They take their own time. Maybe months, and sometimes people work with me for a year and more, depending on how much weight they have and come back to their normal weights. So they play a huge role in decreasing obesity, or for that matter, I would even say not put on weight at all. So it helps in prevention. Now let me come to the second topic, diabetes, which is the menace in today's world. Now, understand this. Most of our diets are rich in carbohydrate. Carbohydrate gets digested and finally digestion. At the end of digestion, it becomes a sugar, that is glucose. Glucose enters blood. As soon as it enters the blood, the brain gets a signal and brain asks another organ called pancreas to deal with this. What does pancreas do? It releases a chemical or a hormone called insulin. Insulin, what is the job of insulin? It does not do anything with the glucose. It's like a postman. It picks up glucose from the blood and delivers it into every cell of the body. Inside the cell, many, many reactions happen to finally give us energy. Now, understand it this way. If my meal had no fiber at all, just now I've explained, now this meal is going to get digested very quickly. And after digestion, it is going to dump a large amount of glucose into the bloodstream. And now the brain will tell pancreas, make more insulin because we have more glucose to deal with. Pancreas overworks and makes more insulin, and this is cleared off. How long? 30 years, 40 years? After that, your pancreas is going to say, I was designed for 90 years, but you made me overwork every day, every meal, and I'm tired. I cannot make insulin the way I used to make. And so the amount of insulin decreases. And of course, there's much more, that is the effectiveness, that is the insulin resistance also comes into picture, which is the other half of the story, which I'm not getting into. And now, when insulin efficiency and the amounts come down, we develop type 2 diabetes. That is, the glucose is left behind in our bloodstreams and we develop type 2 diabetes. It is just our foolishness of not having enough fiber in our diet which is creating diabetes. Now, there are two things. One, if you're not diabetic, you can prevent diabetes. If you're already diabetic, you can still control your blood sugars by including a lot of fiber in your food. My clients who walk into my clinic, they in just 4 to 6 weeks, that's the beauty of the body. It doesn't need another 30 years to correct itself. Just 4 to 6 weeks, people drop off medications or taper their medication, remove insulin and reverse their type 2 diabetes and walk. So it is that simple and so beautiful. And coming to the heart health, now both hypertension and dyslipidemia, let me deal with this. Now, fiber has two beautiful qualities when it comes to dyslipidemia. Lot of plant fiber, because it doesn't get digested in the stomach or till the small intestine, they move into the large intestine. In the large intestine, the bacteria break them down. And one of the byproducts is a short chain fatty acid. Look at the beauty of those mechanisms inside the body. This fatty acid, a type of fatty acid, which is the fats produced in the large intestine, is going to inform the liver that some fats have been produced. You synthesize less cholesterol. So the synthesis of cholesterol and triglycerides in the liver itself comes down. And after they circulate, they go back to the liver. But when they are going back to the liver, the excess cholesterol, again, if we have enough plant fiber in the small intestine, will be absorbed and will be thrown out in the stool. So excess plant fiber helps in decreasing the synthesis of cholesterol and increasing the excretion of cholesterol. And that's how it corrects our dyslipidemia in the blood, that is, it balances the cholesterol, triglycerides, and LDL in our blood and helps to decrease the risk of heart diseases. Coming to the hypertension. Now, I want you to take your attention to the insulin. Every time we eat food without fiber, it increases or spikes up glucose in our blood. Every time we spike up glucose in the blood, we spike up insulin because we have demanded more insulin and body produces more insulin. This insulin's main job is to transport glucose from the blood to the cells. But insulin has secondary functions. It is called an anabolic hormone. Anabolism means building. Catabolism is breaking down. So this insulin is also responsible for building, which means to say that over a period of time, where if we keep on increasing insulin in our blood every day, smooth muscles get built up in our arteries and veins. When the walls become thicker and less pliable, the body has to increase pressure to supply blood to every part of the body. Not just this, many more mechanisms happen. Say for another example, every time we spike up insulin, there is a tendency for kidneys to reabsorb sodium. When sodium is reabsorbed, we have to kidneys have to reabsorb water. Now the volume of blood increases, so the work on the heart increases. This way, the hypertension also increases. So these are some of the effects of no fiber in our diet. And of course, in the gut, we all very, very well know that in the large intestine, they absorb water and add bulk to our stool and help us remove everything which is unwanted, which is toxic, which is chemical in the system through the stool on an everyday basis. It doesn't create constipation. Constipation is the mother of all diseases. So gut is cleared off of all the toxins and unwanted matter and undigested food also. When this happens properly, most of the larger gut diseases like diverticulosis, hemorrhoids, or even the autoimmune disorders, cancers can all be avoided with just fiber. So if you look at right from obesity to the diseases of the gut, all can be prevented by just including fiber. That is why I said it is very important to increase fiber. Now let me tell you in a couple of minutes how to increase fiber in our food. I'm going back to my plate. Now let me take up the first part. In the first part, all our grains should become whole grains. So when I say whole grains, rice should become unpolished. People who use rice in different dishes, be very careful. It's not just about rice. It is rice everywhere, whether you're making your rotis or dosas, idlis, your puliogre, or your pulavs and biryanis, everywhere rice should become unpolished. When it comes to flours, you are buying the commercially made flours is very, very wrong. Because how are your rotis made? Your rotis are so soft and fluffy. When they become softer and softer, we think that is the best brand to buy. But that's the last thing to do. If your rotis are softer, it simply means to say your fiber is not there, which means to say there is no nutrition. So you are eating rotis day in and day out without fiber and nutrition. So what is the solution? My grandmother's solution. I have to buy the grain, whatever that grain is, whether it is wheat, rice, ragi, jowar, bajra, any millet for that matter, buy the grain, go to the flour mill, get it floured and do not sieve. But I know you in America cannot afford to do that. But we have domestic mills today, exactly similar to our juicers and mixers. You can have a small one, buy a small one and put it on your kitchen counter and make fresh atta every single day just before you make that. It's the one of the best investments you can do for yourself. And it's very essential. Coming to the rava, when you make upmas, you use those Bombay rava or the upma rava, which is the smallest of the rava, which neither has nutrition nor fiber. You have to use thick rava. Here in Karnataka, we call it bansi rava. And coming to poha, it has to be very thick and if possible red, because it's coming from the unpolished rice. It should be so thick that it needs more than 2 hours of soaking. If you can soak your poha and put it into seasoning, that's the last thing you should be doing. And coming to millets, millets also can be polished like rice and removed from the outermost layer. So ensure your millets also are unpolished. If you are eating oats, it should be steel cut oats. It should not be your flaked oats. Absolutely, they are processed. And I'm going to the next part, coming to the grams and dals. Grams, we have no problem because their husks are intact. But dals, they cut it and polish it. So it is very important to buy the dals with husk, that is the skin. Buy green gram dal, urad dal, tuar dal, masoor dal, all your dals with skin. And coming to the third and fourth part, your vegetables, whether they're being used for cooked or raw, keep the skin on. So which brings us to the topic of buy everything organic or without any chemicals and pesticides used, and keep all the outer parts of your food intact, right from potatoes to radish to turnips to beetroots to carrots. Never peel off the skin of anything. Keep them all intact. And coming to the fruits, fruit should never be part of your meal because fruits are simple sugars and everything else is a complex carbohydrate. Simple sugars get digested quickly. Say 1.5-2 hours, all your fruits will be digested and they should be getting out of the stomach. Otherwise, if you eat them with the meal, they get putrefied in the stomach and they can create gas, flatulence, and a little cramps in the stomach. And there could be some loss of nutrients also. So always eat fruits separately between meals. And this is all about how do you increase fiber, which means to say, I'm not talking about changing your dishes or your recipes. Continue to make the same, but what goes into them is what matters. So change your ingredients and you get all the fiber and all the benefits I have spoken about till now. Now the only point, these are some examples which I want you to see. The polished poha and the unpolished thick poha, the polished rava, the thick rava, the unpolished grain rice and the steel cut oats. And these are your dals. And coming to sugars and salt, these also should be unrefined. Ban table sugar, that is the refined sugar in your lives. Use unrefined black color, yuck looking jaggery in small amounts occasionally to make your sweets at home using whole grains or dals and grams. Salt and salt should become unrefined sea salt or the Himalayan rock salt. And oils should always be cold pressed oils. Use any oil you want, which preferably should be the oil which any people have been using in your families. And that should be cold pressed. Don't worry about these, saturated, unsaturated, omega-3s, omega-6s, monounsaturated, and polyunsaturated. Every oil will have all of these concoctions. I've given you an example of olive oil and peanut oil. They're so similar. They have everything, monounsaturated, polyunsaturated, saturated. All of them are present. So don't worry about which oil you're using. Use cold-pressed oil in the minimum amounts because body doesn't want oils in their bottle form. It needs in their natural form, like your nuts and seeds and peanuts, coconuts, copra, till, and avocados and things like this. Increase all of this in your cooking or in your foods and keep the oil as such as minimum as possible. So I have covered all the main groups of foods which are necessary. The more you eat these, you're closer to non-disease states. Now, this is one thing which is not present in my plate. I don't prescribe this. I don't add this into my prescription at all, which is animal products. Let me briefly, maybe a couple of minutes, spend on this. Why not animal products? Now, a lot of research is being done in the last couple of decades, and we know more than enough data today what animal products do to us. See, like all other foods, animal products look at the major nutrients. Carbohydrates. There are no carbohydrates at all in animal products. Dairy does have small amount of carbohydrates. Coming to the fats, all animal foods have cholesterol and saturated fatty acids, both of which are going to increase our weight, increase our fat content, and clog our arteries and veins and lead to many, many diseases and disorders. Nothing nice about the fats in animals. Now, coming to the animal proteins, till now, even today, my textbooks will declare that animal proteins are superior proteins and complete proteins. Yes, they are, but we know that they are very, very harmful. They increase inflammation, they increase oxidative stress, and are risk factors for tumors and cancers in human beings. There is so much work being done by very eminent scientists, researchers, clinicians, and doctors all over the world. I've listed some of them. Please go to their websites and look into the research papers and data they have published. All of them point towards how much harmful animal proteins are. Nutritionally, they absolutely do not do any good to us, but harm to us. Look at the other side. Today, animal agriculture is very, very pathetic. They give a lot of antibiotics, which reach us in small amounts, and we become drug resistant. Even more important for me as a nutritionist is they kill my gut bacteria. Gut microbiota is very, very, very important to keep us healthy, prevent all diseases, and even reverse diseases, because today we understand our guts are wired to the brain. Our guts are wired to the immune system. Our guts are wired to the metabolic system. Everything which happens inside our bodies, literally these little organisms dictate terms. So it is very important to keep my gut bacteria, the variety, the variability, and the numbers in a perfect state, without which we cannot be healthy at all. And of course, commercially, all of these animal products get a lot of hormones. First, they carry animal hormones. Second, we add chemical form of hormones, which are actually ruining us. You know, they are, reacting with our natural hormones and creating havoc with our health. So these are the ill effects of animal protein and the benefits of plant protein. I would recommend all of you to watch this documentary Netflix, you know, The Game Changers. It is really life-changing. You will see all the experts who talk about how harmful and why animal proteins are very harmful. So it is very important for us to remove animal proteins or animal foods in general from our diets. And I would, I don't know if I have time. This is one of the most powerful, very brief videos I have seen. I would definitely want you to just listen to it, and I end my talk with this.
Hello, my name is Dr. Brooke Goldner, and I'm a board certified physician, and I am specialized in disease reversal using nutrition. Now, before I ever became a doctor, I actually was a patient. I was diagnosed at 16 years old with lupus. I had stage 4 kidney failure. I had blood clots that caused mini strokes. I endured years of chemotherapy and steroids just to survive. Now, all I've ever learned never helped me with my health. It was always about survival. I did 3 years of genetic research at Carnegie Mellon. I went to medical school. I was chief resident, and yet I still needed medicine to survive. 12 years I was sick. And then 15 years ago, I changed my diet to a plant-based diet. I got rid of dairy, no animal products, and within 3 months, the lupus was gone. I have been healthy for 15 years with no sign of disease. I've had children, and I've dedicated my life to this. And over the past decade, I have helped thousands of people reverse lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, multiple sclerosis, diabetes, heart disease, number one killer, all by getting them to stop eating meat and dairy and eggs and focus on vegetables and high-nutrient plant foods. And the results are consistent, and they are profound. As a doctor, my colleagues can attest to the fact that we are chasing down an epidemic of disease that we cannot hope to catch up to or overtake, because people are getting sicker with every meal they eat. But you can make that difference, because people don't know who to trust. But if the dietary guidelines say that people should be focusing on a plant-based diet full of vegetables and fruits, and they should be limiting or eliminating meat and dairy and eggs, they will have at least the right information to start making better decisions. Listen, both as a doctor that is just trying to save lives,
Yes, we have alternatives in plant. We don't have to bother too much. And it is good not just for us, for the whole ecology or the plant, planet Earth. So we just have one planet and one body. Let's take care of it. Thank you so much. I'm sorry, Doctor. I must have taken a few more minutes than given to me, I think.
No, no problem. That was a very eye-opening talk. I hope everybody enjoyed. Definitely. I think we need such talks. And I mean, you've got the both East and West combination. That's the language is very important, because people tend to believe in the Western way of looking at things.
Absolutely.
And now this perspective is very important, and connecting to the bridging the gap is what you have done. It's really wonderful. I think people might have a lot of questions, but we have limited time. I'll make the announcement and then we'll do the questions
sure.
quick. So in the meantime, while you're typing the questions, so we have prepared a class exclusively for teaching a Siddha way of cooking.
Mm-hmm.
So that's this weekend we're going to have a Siddha culinary workshop.
Oh.
Teach people how to use whole grains, whole millets, all from natural materials. How do you prepare a healthy food? So we are giving around 25 recipes. Wow. It's just a two-day, it's a webinar online, and people can know. So a couple of us, we have more than 30 years of experience in cooking, tribal food and ancient way of cooking. So Miss Lakshmi, Velraj and Hai, both of are teaching. So it's a wonderful course. If you wanted to attend, there are a lot of reviews from the past, because we had a whole Siddha culinary course that was very successfully done last year. So definitely, you know, people should think about taking this course. And then we have our free courses. Any kid who want to join our free courses, like to learn yoga, not just yoga, to develop emotional intelligence, and learn culinary practices, home gardening, and many other respect, and organizing, self-organizing, all these things are taught freely. For we have more than 100 students join now every Monday, Wednesday, Friday. So we have students. We are running a Carnatic music classes. If you're interested, kids and parents can join. So we have two-day Carnatic music classes in a week. And then we have our diploma degree in holistic integrated medicine that's ongoing. So, and people can join anytime. So these are our courses. So in the meantime, I will just look at the questions, and I will you can answer perhaps. So are you looking at the chat button, or you want me to read it out?
Okay. Yeah, should we go to the first one?
Yeah, the first one is thank you. So thanks so much. Why do you doctors say we need to have an iodine from salt? So that's the first question.
At one point of time, we did need, because there was so much rampant iodine deficiency. Iodine is necessary to absorb the thyroid better. So it is very thyroid function. So we need iodine. But right now, unless we live in hilly regions where the soil is eroded and there is no iodine in the soil, which will not enter into our food, we don't need it. So many times I see my clients having problems with excess iodine. So it is very essential not to have iodine at all. And the second question, doctor? What if I feel dehydrated a lot. Please have all the foods which are full in liquids, fruits, vegetables, green leafy vegetables, even water for that matter. And the next question was, thank you. Thanks for all of your wonderful comments. Iodine, then seedless fruits. Yes, even when they are seedless, we still have the stuff outer covering. So that still works for us. Okay, and what else? Can you provide your contact? Doctor, definitely you can share my contact number and anybody can contact me on WhatsApp. Dry fasting, I would definitely not recommend dry fasting because we need to flush out the toxins from our body and we need water. Definitely not dry fasting. Doctor, you can tell me when I can stop.
Yeah, well, we can go for another 3 minutes.
So animal protein makes me feel satiated. Yes, definitely, because both fats and protein add satiety. But that's not the right way of satisfying ourselves, is what I was trying to say. Plant protein tend to, I overeat. Doesn't matter. Listen to your body. You eat till you feel full. The biggest secret is you have to chew well and eat very, very, very slowly. Most of the time, most people eat mindlessly, and that's the problem. Then how does the refined food lose germ? See, for example, if I have to talk about wheat, the industry which makes atta or the flour, the very first thing they do is remove the outer covering and the germ out of it. Germ has a different market, a huge market, and gets more money. And your atta will be only empty carbohydrates with very little fiber in it. And that's my whole problem. How do we know whether the millets are polished? Generally, the color of your millets will be lighter than its original form. Like rice, you know, if they're polished, they are shining white. Similarly, even your millets will be. But that's not very easy to find out. I agree with you. What causes thyroid? See, the hormones coming from outside is the biggest cause. So stop animal products, half your problems will be solved. Then how can we use brown rice instead of unpolished rice? Exactly similar way. Take this rice instead of that rice. Wash them, soak them, and use in whatever form you want. Fasting and diabetes, please do it under supervision from a naturopath or any physicians in your family who agree with this. I know doctors, allopaths will not agree with this, but somebody who can just check your blood sugars and ensure you don't get into hypoglycemia. Or you could always get in touch with me. Alcohol, okay? No, it's neither, not food at all. It's poison. Do I have any wheat products that have germ? It is 100% whole wheat flour. If you can get organic such things in Indian stores, you are safer. I think that's it for now, doctor.
Yeah, wonderful. I think, you know, it was an eye-opener and people definitely benefited today. And more questions we will we'll discuss. So we, if you want, I mean, one of the things we were looking at is in our diploma courses, as we look into different things, we add courses for our diploma. And if there is a requirement, then, you know, if a lot of people are asking, then there's a possibility we can have a nutrition course too.
I have designed something called Holistic Nutrition Course of 25 hours, which teaches whatever I've done in great detail with evidence. And I just finished two courses in Singapore and came back last week. And it was very well accepted. So if something of that kind is an interest, I can always do that.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, doctor, and for providing this space.
You're welcome. And Surya, I don't know if Surya is here. Is he here? Surya?
I don't see him.
Okay, Raja Suryadeva. Okay, so thank him for connecting us, and he's our key coordinator in the California area. So I thank everyone for this, you know, staying late, and have a good night today.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good night to everybody.
Thank you.